my flesh, shall I see God? Shall I see God? I know that my Redeemer liveth. Christ risen, for now is Christ risen from the dead. The first fruits of them, that sleep.
Amen. Good morning, everyone. Christ the Lord is risen. Well, good morning. I thought we should high five when we came walking out. It was like a superhero duo or something. Anyway, good morning. My name is Ryan. Every time. I'm the pastor here at Central. It's great to be with you guys on this beautiful Easter morning, and indeed a happy Easter and Resurrection Sunday to all of you. This is our version, really, of the sunrise service, and so welcome to our sunrise gathering here at Central. I'm glad that you're here. If you're a first-time guest, I want to say a special welcome. We're glad you're here, or any guests joining us online, welcome. And if you wouldn't mind, I'd love to invite you to swing by our Welcome Center, which is just over here behind that wall. There's a giant sign above that says Welcome Center. Kirsten Gill is in there, and she would love to say hello to you and give you a free gift. We always give out gifts when people come because we want to be hospitable and give out free things. So please go by and visit her and say hello. We won't take any blood from you or any money or anything like that. So just a free gift if you want to go by and say hello to her. Also, if you want more information about who we are, what we're all about, and even our worship pages, you can scan the QR code in front of you on the pew back. You can use your phone. Insert, it's okay. We won't judge you or yell at you or stone you or anything like that. At least I won't. But you can scan that QR code, and there's a lot of info about who we are and our worship pages. You can kind of follow along using that QR code. That's all I got, Sonia. What do you got?
Well done. My name is Sonia Knutson. I'm the pastoral associate here at Central, so welcome on behalf of Ryan and I again. I want to put a couple of announcements in front of you. On April 14th, it is our congregation night out. It's a Central night out. We're going to Whirly Ball in Maple Grove. We're also going to have childcare here, so if you're children are a little bit smaller than maybe this, you please know that you can come and drop their kids off here at the FLC, and Ben and Isabel will have wonderful opportunities for them to play. But we also, again, as adults and as younger children or teenagers, we can go out and get to know each other a little bit more and hang out and have a great time. So you can sign up online, but you can also stop at the Welcome Center and get more information on that.
Also coming up, if you are interested at all in learning more about who we are here at Central and maybe possibly thinking about becoming a member here, this is not for you to come and sign up that night, although you can if you want to. But if you want to just kind of learn more about who we are, we do have a Discover Central class. It's like a new member or those interested in membership classes coming up on April 9th. You can register online. There's no cost, of course. It goes from 6:30 to 8 o'clock, and you can go visit the Welcome Center and talk to Kirsten or go online or on that QR code. You can register there. So come and hang out and learn more about Central if you want to. Also then, Vacation Bible School is coming up. Can you believe it? It's already almost summertime. So this is for, it's June 24th or 27th for ages 4 years old through fifth grade. Ben and Isabel do a wonderful job. And so if you want to come be a part of Vacation Bible School as a leader or as a young person, or if you want to just donate some money to help fund some kids that can't afford to come or to make the cost lower, please donate. There's a table in the lobby. It's got a giant monkey hanging from the ceiling. That's how you'll know you're in the right place. Or talk to Ben and Isabel, but please be part of our VBS coming up this summer. We're excited about it. At least be praying for them, so that'd be awesome to have you be a part of it.
We also have a photo opportunity out for you in the lobby right past the Vacation Bible School table, so if you want to hang out after a family and take a photo op, please do that, and then tag Central if you put it on social media. We would love to see who has been a part of today, because we're probably not going to have a chance to go and visit all of you today.
I'm going to try.
Ryan will try
high
hard.
High five everybody.
And then our last announcement is in 2 weeks on April 14th, we're going to start our new sermon series. It's called
This One's going to be awesome. I've just got to tell you, I'm super excited about it.
Do you want to do the announcement?
No, go ahead.
You go for it.
Fine.
I'm kidding. This sermon series is called How Do We Get There? It's going to be a walk through the book of Genesis. So just in case you want to do your homework ahead of time, go ahead and start reading through that, and then we can compare notes as we walk through that series. And also next Sunday, we're having a guest speaker, Kent Dobson.
Yes, we are.
Yes, and the men's retreat is going to be
next
Saturday.
Men's retreat's coming on Saturday, so we have a lot going on. By the way, how do we get here? We want to just sort of go through Genesis, how do we get here, but also like, hey, what are you doing with your life? How are you? Where are you going? What's your journey like? So that's kind of what we're going to talk about that whole series, so it should be incredible.
Yeah, especially through most of the characters through the book of Genesis. Yeah. We're going to ask you to stand at this time.
Christ
the Lord is risen. And let us sing together.
Jesus died, some of his friends laid his body in a big tomb. They sealed it shut with a large round stone. Soldiers guarded the tomb. 3 days later, the earth shook. An angel of the Lord came down from heaven and pushed the stone away from the tomb. Then the angel sat on the stone. When the soldiers saw the angel, they fell to the ground. Mary was walking to the tomb with some of her friends. They saw the angel, who said, "Do not be afraid. Jesus is not here. He has risen. Go and tell Peter and the other disciples that Jesus is alive." On their way, the woman saw Jesus. They fell to their knees and worshiped him. Jesus smiled and said, "Go to the others, that I will see them in Galilee." So Mary ran to tell the disciples.
Our next reading is from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verse 25. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. And our next reading is from 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, verse 35 through 44. It can be found on page 936 in your pew Bible. But someone will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come? Fool, what you sow does not come to life unless it dies. And as for what you sow, you do not sow the body that is to be, but a bare seed, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. But God gives it a body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed its own body. Not all flesh is alike, but there is one flesh for human beings, another for animals, another for birds, and another for fish. There are both heavenly bodies and earthly bodies, but the glory of the heavenly is one thing, and that of the earthly is another. There is one glory of the sun, and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars. Indeed, star differs from star in glory. So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable, what is raised is imperishable. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a physical body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a physical body, there is also a spiritual body.
Amen. Thank you, Dan. Let us pray this morning. God, we give you thanks so much for this beautiful message of resurrection life. And we do ask, God, that you would help us to understand this idea of life this morning. And God, by your grace, by the life and death and, of course, the resurrection of your Son, would you give us new life, God, in all the ways that we need it so desperately. And would you bless us this morning as we gather, God? Would you awaken us in all the ways we've fallen asleep? And would you enliven us in all the ways that we have gone dormant? And bless our time together in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You can be seated. Well, good morning, everyone. Man, it's good to see you guys. This is a new day, as it were. This morning, I want to talk with you about the gospel according to guacamole. Are you with me so far? I'm going to need my apron for this, though. A couple of years ago, my son Gavin, who's actually here, by the way, he's in the back there, so I started making guacamole at the house. And he had worked at Chipotle years ago and picked up some tips and tricks. That's what I wanted to say. And but he started making it on his own at home and sort of mastered this guacamole. And he makes it for us, I don't know, regularly. I got to tell you, it's legit pretty good. And here's how he makes it. He takes an avocado, of course, like you do. You cut that avocado open. You got to get rid of the seed. I'm going to leave that seed right here. And then he takes the, I got my spoon here, puts the avocado in this bowl. Also then, he takes some fresh jalapeno peppers, or as I like to call them, jalapenos. He chops up those jalapenos and puts those, almost lost my seed there, and puts those in the guac as well, dice those babies up. Then he takes, after this, Put those in the bowl here. Some fresh onion. By the way, the sacristy smells like onions, so if you want to smell some onions, go on back into the sacristy. Smells delicious back there. Chops up some onions, and those go right into the bowl. Then, of course, you can't do some jalapenos and some onions and what else do I got? Oh, guac, avocado without your cilantro. Got to have some fresh cilantro in there. I love me some cilantro for my guacamole. Right in the bowl. By the way, they got to be red onions, too. They can't be just regular onions. They got to be red onions. And then, of course, to top things off, you need some fresh lime juice. Are you with me so far? Anybody hungry just yet? Now, here's the deal about all these ingredients. All these ingredients, not too long ago, were all living. So like I said, the avocado was living. The limes from the lime juice, living. The cilantro, living. And of course, the onions, living. So here's how you eat guac, by the way, then. Look at that guac. Well done, Gavin. Way to go, buddy. I should have brought some water up here. But all these things were living. So in order to get the avocado, you, of course, had to take the avocado and cut it down from the avocado tree. And to get that fresh red onion, you have to cut it down from the from the ground. You thought I didn't know where onions came from, didn't you? I know where they come from. And the cilantro from the cilantro bush? I don't know where cilantro. The herb garden. And, of course, the lime. You got to cut down. Where my limes go? From the lime tree. All these ingredients were not too long ago living. But in order for them to make it into Gavin's good time guacamole, which is what I call it, by the way, you gotta have a good name for your guacamole, they had to be severed from their life source, the vine, the tree, whatever it was giving them life, they had to be severed from that, cut off from that, in order to make it into this plate or this bowl. That's how it works. You know, all your food was once living. All of it was, not too long ago, it was all living. But it had to be severed from that life source, from that vine or that from the ground or from that tree in order to make it to your bowl or your plate. It had to die, which is a good time to mention that. If you ever go to a place to eat and your food is not dead on your plate, if it's alive, I would leave right away and just go somewhere else. But all your food was once living. That's how it works. And you know, as humans, we have to eat to be alive. You probably know this or recognize this already. And food gives us life. And so in order for us to have life, to get life, our food has to die in order for us to get life from it. Which means this, that death is the engine of life. That's how it works. The worm is eaten by the bird. It gives it life. The bird is, of course, eaten by the cat, which gives it life. The wolf eats the cat. And then years later, probably that wolf is eaten by the grandchildren of that very first worm. Death is the engine of life. And in fact, the more recently your food has been living, the better it is for you. The fresher your food, the better it is for the body, the more nutritious it is for you. Which is why we can then know that the nutritional deficiency of the Twinkie, for example, which was never really alive or living, and why it doesn't give you life. It can't give you life because it was never living. Most things that are not alive are like this, except for the crumble cookie, which is not living technically, but is still heavenly and good and delicious for the body. But all your food gives you life because it was once living. See, the death of this one thing, of this onion and this avocado and this cilantro and this lime and this jalapeno, the death of this thing gives us life. Our survival, our sustenance, our very beings are dependent on this other living thing. That's how it works. There's death and life in this cycle of death giving life all around us. Your skin is not that different. Did you know this? Your skin is constantly dying off and flaking off and turning into dust, which you probably vacuum up later on or dust up into a dustpan. So there are bits of you in your vacuum cleaner right now, probably as we speak. But your body regrows itself, or your skin anyway, every 30 days. Do you know this? There's a picture of your skin in case you forgot what it looks like. Or how about fertilizer? The best fertilizer is actually manure. What's manure but just dead and decomposing waste that came from another living being? And you put it in the ground and it brings life. Or how about the seasons? It's springtime almost, I think. I don't want to curse it, but it looks like it's maybe springtime. The birds are out this morning anyway. And every spring, at least in Minnesota, two things just burst to life, even though we never thought it would ever happen. Like the trees begin to bud, flowers begin to bloom, the grass, believe it or not, begins to grow yet again. It's how it works. It's amazing. And then at the end of summertime or in the fall, things begin to go dormant again. And they stop growing and they stop sort of being alive in this way. And the trees stop growing, the grass doesn't grow, and the flowers stop blooming. And of course, fast forward through winter again to spring, and things become alive once again. That's how it works. Death and life and death and life, death and life, avocados and red onions and jalapenos and cilantro and skin and manure and seasons, death to life is all around us. Back to the avocado, by the way, if you ever want to grow a new avocado tree, you take this seed and you bury it in the ground, which is often what we do with dead things, don't we? We put them into the ground. And that seed will burst open after it dies and will grow into new life, a new tree. And that tree will produce more avocados. It's death to life all around us. Death is the engine of life. Death gives life to the physical universe all around us. So it's no wonder that when the Bible tells the story about God bringing life, new life into the world, how does it go? Well, Jesus shows up, who's the Son of God, and he dies, and he goes into the ground, and he raises again to new life. And in doing so, he brings life to the whole world. Death brings life, and he brings us with us, Paul says and suggests in his writing. And so when God sends his own Son, Jesus, to the world, he has to die. That's how it works. See, the cross is not just true sacramentally. The cross is true at every level. And in our own lives, death brings life. Death is life all over the place, even in the story of God, which is actually our story. You see, God giving life through Jesus' death and resurrection is not some kind of new idea in the history of the universe. Rather, it's God using the way the universe was already created, living in tune and in rhythm with the way the universe was created in the beginning. Which is why then Jesus says in Matthew 16, he says this, hey, whoever wants to be my disciple, they must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their life will lose it. But whoever loses their life will save it and will find it. See, Jesus keeps saying again and again things like this about what it means to really be fully alive. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about the difference between the Greek words that mean life. And when he says life, he means abundant, full, rich life. Not just your heart pumping and your blood moving around, that you're awake. No, life, real abundant life. And whoever grasps for their own life will lose it. Whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. That's what Jesus says. So what does it mean to be fully alive? It means to take up your cross, to be a servant, to give your life away on behalf of other people, to give your life away, to die so that you can actually live. Jesus teaches us how to die so that you and I can live, which raises the question, what needs to die in you in order that you might find life? What in you needs to die that you can really live? By the way, you got a little piece of paper when you came in, I think, a little white piece of paper. Grab that out. You might need it in just a minute. But what do you need to die to so that you can actually really and truly live? What part of us needs to die? This whole sermon series, we talk about a lot of things. Maybe it's your incessant desire to control everything. If that's you, say amen. I'm just kidding. Don't say that. Maybe it's your desire to be superior, to always be winning. Maybe it's your relentless, wanting to see your enemies punished. Maybe it's that. Maybe it's your expectations. Maybe it's popularity. What are you clinging to that you need to let go of that you can experience life? Maybe it's the part of you that's not real, you know what I mean? Like the part of you that you've fabricated over time, that when you were little you needed to survive, but now it becomes this mask that you wear and preserve and protect, that you put forward in the world in order to earn approval of other people, in order to look good or be right, to be powerful or to win. And here's the thing about that, we call it the false self. It's exhausting to prop up that part of ourselves that's not real, that isn't authentic, that we're trying to present to the world. It's this exhausting, never-ending race. And it isn't really who we really are, in fact. It's this constructed facade. And we spend copious amounts of energy trying to maintain this and protect our image. And all the while, it's robbing us of life. See, Jesus invites us to let go, finally, once and for all, to give up and to die, to lose our lives so that we can live and have life. That's why he came. So what is it? Maybe it's an addiction. Maybe it's the first half of life. Maybe it's your expectations or the pressure on your children or your spouse. Maybe what you want from them. You need to let that die. Maybe it's your own self-centeredness or your overinflated ego or something like that. What is it? Maybe it's this. You ever notice how hard it is to say you're sorry, to apologize? Why is it so hard to say I'm sorry? Maybe it's just me, but I think it's this. Because saying you're sorry is a kind of death. It's saying, hey, I'm going to stop this game and this cycle right here and right now and say, hey, I'm going to let go of this desire to win or to be right or to look good or to be on top, to be superior. I'm sorry. And it feels like death. Can I get an amen on that one? A couple of you know what I'm talking about. How about your own popularity? It's this trap, right? The reason popularity is such a trap or trying to attain or drive or strive after popularity is because deep beneath this idea, this obsession that we want others to like us, is this idea that I'm not already loved. But what if you already were loved? What if the cross was a message that I've embraced you and I already love you? So today, give up. Let go. Release. Let the thing die. Because you and I are saved not by the things that we do, not by our good works or by how holy we are or by anything else, but we're saved and given life through the death and resurrection of Jesus and our participation in that death and resurrection, as Paul writes. This is what baptism is. We are baptized into his death so we can experience a death like his. And then Paul says, and we can be resurrected like his resurrection. This is what we're doing. Life, death, life, death. And the ironic thing is, the more we hold on to these things, the more we grip tightly to our own lives or the things that we refuse to let go, whatever that thing is, the harder we hold on to that, the more we grip onto it, the more we lose our life and it slips through our fingers. Is this you, I wonder, maybe? Holding on for dear life to something that you just refuse to let go of for whatever reason. And all the while, it's robbing you of life. Central Lutheran Church this morning, may you know that life is death all around us and death is life. This is the cycle of the universe, how it works. And death always brings about new life. So, of course, Jesus' death in this magnificent way gives us brand new life. And this morning, may you lose your life in order that you may find it. And may the love of God release you from any fear or striving or holding on or gripping or grasping. And may you trust in the risen Jesus this morning. Now, I want you to take that piece of paper. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to sing a song here. And we're going to respond like this. We're going to sing a song, we're going to do some prayers, and then we're going to do, we always pass an offering globe. If you're a guest here, please don't feel obligated to give. If you're not a guest, you can drop your offering in there. You can do it online this way. And all this stuff that we, you know, all the offerings go to helping us run this place. But in that offering globe as well, I'd love for you to write down one thing on that sheet of paper. What's the one thing that you feel like God is asking you to finally once and for all, hey, let it go, let it die, so that you can have life? What's the thing that you're holding on to that is prohibiting you from receiving life this morning? Write it down. You can crumple it up or ball it up, I don't care, and then throw it in the offering globe as it goes by you. Sound all right? And then we'll do that together this morning as we sing. So Central, may you let go and receive life this morning. Amen.
Alleluia, 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 Christ is risen, Alleluia.
this table this morning, releasing all of the things that have control over us, the things that separate us from you. And as we receive this gift this morning of communion, this gift that you gave us so many years ago, this gift that you gave your 12 friends, and you said, remember me through this gift. May we also remember you and the plans that you have for us in our lives. And the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat, for this is my body given to you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after supper, he took the cup. He gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant given and shed for you and for all people. Do this in remembrance of me. And he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. At this time, we're going to serve communion. Please await the invite of the ushers during this process. There will be four stations. You may take a wafer and dip it in the first cup, which is wine, or the second cup, which is grape juice. We also have prepackaged containers that have a gluten-free wafer with it. So if you have an allergy concern, please feel free to take this package. Please know at this table, all are welcome and all are loved. Thank you. May the power and the grace of his blood and of his body bless you and keep you in all that you do.
Let's pray. God, we give you thanks this morning for your life, that your death has led to life. And this morning, God, would you free us up to experience your goodness and your depth of life. And God, we ask for you to resurrect all the dead parts of us, God, that we need so badly. And help us once and for all to let go of all these things that clog us up from receiving the gifts you have for us. So enable us by your Spirit to let go, to lose our life so that we might indeed truly find it. And we pray these things in your holy and precious name. Amen. Christ the Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.
I'm going to have you receive the benediction in just one moment. We're going to sing one more song here. But before you go, if you're a guest, we'd want to remind you just to swing by that welcome center on the way out. And we'd love to say hello to you. But in the meantime, would you receive the benediction this morning? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May he be gracious to you. May he grant you favor and peace and wisdom. And may you know in the deepest parts of your souls you are God's beloved sons and God's beloved daughters. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Take a picture over here if you want to.